Okay. We can be seated. Okay. If we can be seated, it would be appreciated. Especially today, I feel like saying, where is everybody? What happened? Is there an event or something out of town? Maybe people come late because they know I start late. Okay. Huh? Yeah, really? Terrible. Terrible. There's a show in Indio? Oh, yeah, I heard about it. Is that the one that's $1,000? $1,000 for six nights? Yeah. Very popular thing. Not 2,200? The scalper price is now up to 2,200. Well, you know, I didn't think we had anybody in the congregation that could afford either 1,000 or 2,200. Yeah. All right. Okay. Well, for those of you who showed up and on time, let me welcome you. For most of you who have been here before, you know about our congregation. But let me kind of share about the big picture. I like talking about the big picture, the great historical expanse of things. And I'm still stalling around, hoping some more people show up. Okay, now. All right, here we are in the midst of a great historical event. You say, well, wait a minute, I just got out of bed and I brushed my teeth and what's the deal? I'm here and this is a great historical event. Yes, it is. We're part of a great historical event. And that is that for 2,000 years, there has been a great misunderstanding. And you'd think that in 2,000 years that it would get straightened out. Because there's so much scholarship. I mean, there's been so much study of the scriptures. The Jewish people have studied the scriptures and pored over them endlessly in people's occupations. They do it all day, every day, and so on and so forth. And then there's the Christians and seminaries and Bible studies and people just continually going and seminaries and so on and so forth. And can you believe with all of that, that there has been a great misunderstanding. No one seems to have been able to figure it out in 2,000 years. You say, well, what is the big mystery that is so difficult to figure out and that nobody's been able to actually come to a resolution for 2,000 years? Well, that is that Yeshua, Jesus, is the Messiah. That he actually fulfilled hundreds of prophecies from the Old Testament saying who the Messiah would be, that there would be over 300 prophecies, and he is the only man alive who lived, who could fulfill all of these. So all of them he has either fulfilled or will fulfill, but there's hundreds of them. Okay. I mean, and you'd say, well, with all of that, how can it possibly be missed? But it was. I mean, you know, whoever the Messiah is going to be, he's got to be born in Bethlehem, die for the sins of other people, have his hands and feet pierced, be sold for 30 pieces of silver, on and on, hundreds and hundreds, and yet somehow or other it missed attention. Oh, that's all right. That's all right. Now the Christians, they look at it and say, oh, I got that. Yeah, I'm right there with the prophecies. I know that Christianity, we do recognize that Yeshua, Jesus is the Messiah and so on and so forth. Ah, but there's a problem there too, okay? There's a problem there too because the Christians say, oh, he's not a relative of you Jewish people, okay? He used to be Jewish, okay? Yeshua, Jesus, he used to be Jewish. Did you know? In the year 166 AD, or CE, Common Era, that there was a prohibition against anything Jewish, okay? That if you were to celebrate the Sabbath, that was illegal. In 325 AD, if you were to celebrate the Passover, that would make you a heretic and be excommunicated and worse, okay? And so there was this terrible misunderstanding that said that Yeshua, the Messiah, that he no longer was Jewish. It's a sin. It's a sin to remind anybody that he was Jewish. And this went on with two groups within each establishment felt the need to keep themselves segregated from the other. Okay? And so, if a Jewish person fell over on the floor and the doctor came along, he couldn't treat him. I mean, that's how severe this was. And there was hatred on both sides. So you've heard of anti-Semitism? Let me tell you, in the Jewish community, okay, there were not all kind words for Christians either. Okay, so there's been bigotry on both sides. Now, there has been, there's been something else going on. We live every day, we're on the television, and we are watching the elections and so on and so forth, and there are, and people feel like the one that they're backing has been maligned and falsely spoken about. Well, here we are at this great historical crossroads where the name of Yeshua is going to be cleared. I mean, that's a big thing, clearing the name of the Messiah. He was falsely accused, okay? And how is his name going to be cleared, and what has taken so long? Well, you know, a lot of people weren't that keen on clearing his name. All right, there were forces at work to prevent the clearing of his name. But finally, the world is catching on that he not only is the Messiah, but that he's the Jewish Messiah. What? He's the Jewish Messiah. Yeah, he's a Jewish man. Okay, he fulfilled the Jewish prophecies that were given in the Jewish language by Jewish prophets and so on and so forth. And how? By accepting a Jewish Messiah who lived in a Jewish country, spoke a Jewish language, of Jewish lineage, and so on. How does that make me a Gentile? And it has waited for 2,000 years to clear this up, that, hey, it is the faith of the Bible is centered on the people of Israel, the Jewish people, and so on and so forth. And that Yeshua's name, that he really is the Messiah, and he's not a no-goodnik. Okay? There's been a lot of maligning of his name. It's even a curse word. Okay? Jesus Christ. You've heard it. All right? But his name is being cleared. And his name is being cleared among the Jewish people. That's very important, that his name be cleared among the Jewish people. Because he said, I'm not coming back until the Jewish people in Jerusalem say, welcome are you who comes in the name of the Lord. We accept you as our Messiah. So we say, Maranatha, oh, come quickly. But don't bother with the Jewish people. He's not coming back until the Jewish people get it. Well, guess what? Everybody's been waiting for that to happen, when the Jewish people will welcome him. And everybody's been waiting and waiting and waiting and say, oh, sure, yeah, and that'll happen, oh, yeah. But nobody's been doing anything about it. The great historical event is that finally, there are some people doing something about it. To clear the name of Yeshua, that he is a Jewish man, that he is a Jewish Messiah, that he belongs at the head of the Jewish people and of the faith. So we are about clearing his name. You say, well, what? It's happening so slowly. I've been at it for decades, and it's happening so slowly. God's not in any hurry. Huh? I mean, already there's been thousands of years passed. Okay? That's all right. It's underway. There are over 100,000 Jewish people in this country, 25,000 in Israel, and in some 20 countries there are messianic movements. That's something that is unprecedented. And now you say, well, where are they? Well, Jews for Jesus did a survey that said that only 26% of the Jewish believers in the United States attend a Messianic congregation. Only 26%. That's about what it is in this congregation. Okay? That's up from 10 years ago when it was only 22%. You say, well, what about the other 74%? Well, they're in churches. Well, that's not bad, because they're educating the churches, they're educating the Gentiles about the Jewishness of the faith. That's a legitimate thing to do too. Okay? But things are underway to clear the name of the Messiah. And we are here to, and the fact that you're here amplifies our message to the community with the truth. Finally is out that Yeshua is a Jewish man. It is a Jewish faith. It is legitimate Jewishness to accept Yeshua as the Messiah. Hallelujah. I have stalled around long enough. There are now a sufficient number of people for us to get started fully underway. In the meanwhile, I had to get that said. So, I want to call now Gary Solomon is not here this morning. Okay. So we're going to be having some substitutions. And to get things underway, I want to call on our chauffeur blowers to come forward in a hurry. And let's all rise. Numbers 10 says to call together for a gathering by the blowing of the shofar.
Baruch atah Adonai Eloheinu melech haolam asher kideshenu hindam Yeshua HaMashiach letzivanu leshema kol shofar. Amen. Blessed are thou, Lord God, King of the universe, who sanctify us through the blood of Yeshua HaMashiach and has instructed us to hear the call of the shofar and also remember us his coming back. Amen.
Okay, you remain standing and face the east so we can do the Shema Nevi'ahavta. Shema Yisrael, Adonai Eloheinu, Adonai Echad, Baruch Shem Kivod, Malchuto Leolam Vayed. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. Blessed be his glorious name, whose kingdom is forever and ever. Amen. And we'll give this one a shot. V'yahavta et Adonai Elohecha b'chol levecha u'v'chol nafshecha u'v'chol miyodecha v'hayu hadvarim ha'ele Asher anochi mitzvacha hayom alevavecha v'shinantam levanecha v'bitar babam bishvacha vadecha uvleftecha vaderech ushofbecha uvkumecha ushavtam leot ayadecha V'hayu l'tofot b'neinecha uftavtam al mezuzot b'techa uvisharecha. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your might. These words which I command you this day shall be upon your heart. Teach them diligently to your children. Speak of them when you're sitting in your house, when you're on the road, when you're lying down, and when you're rising up. You shall bind them for a sign upon your hand, and they shall be a symbol between your eyes. Write them on the doorposts of your house and upon your gates. V'ahavta l'recha kamocha, and you shall love your neighbor as yourself. Amen.
Ronnie. Thank you, Gary. What'd I call you? Gary. I said Gary. Jerry. I said Jerry. Baruch et Adonai Hamveil Rock. Baruch Adonai Hamveil Rock Leolam Vayed. Baruch Adonai Hamveil Rock Leolam Vayed. Baruch Ata Adonai Eloheinu Melech HaOlam. Hashir Bacha Bano Mikro HaAmin. Venata Lano Etorato. Baruch Ata Adonai. Noten HaTorah. Amen. Bless the Lord, the Blessed One. Blessed is the Lord, the Blessed One, for all eternity. Blessed are you, O Lord our God, King of the universe, who has chosen us from among the nations and has given us his Torah. Blessed are you, O Lord, giver of the Torah. Amen. Larry.
Shabbat shalom, everybody. Our readings out of the Torah, the Haftorah, and the Brit Hadashah this morning. We're going to start in Deuteronomy 32, 1 to 13. Give ear, O heavens, and I will speak, and hear, O earth, the words of my mouth. Let my teaching drop as the rain, my speech distill as the dew, as raindrops on the tender herb, and as showers on the grass. For I proclaim the name of the Lord. Ascribe greatness to our God. He is the rock. His work is perfect. For all his ways are justice, a God of truth and without injustice, righteousness and upright is he. They have corrupted themselves. They are not his children because of their blemish. A perverse and a crooked generation. Do you thus deal with the Lord? O foolish and unwise people, he is not your father who bought you. He has not made you and established you. Has he not made you and established you? Remember the days of old. Consider the years of many generations. Ask your father and he will show you. You, your elders, and they will tell you. When the Most High divided their inheritance to the nations. When he separated the sons of Adam, he set the boundaries of the peoples according to the number of the children of Israel. For the Lord's portion is his people. Jacob is the place of his inheritance. He found him in a desert land, and in the wasteland, a howling wilderness. He encircled him. He instructed him. He kept him as the apple of his eye. As an eagle stirs up its nest, hovers over its young, spreading out its wings, taking them up, carrying them on its wings. So the Lord alone led him, and there was no foreign God with him. He made him ride in the heights of the earth, that he may eat the produce of the fields. He made him draw honey from the rock and oil from the flinty rock. We'll go now to 2 Samuel 22, 1 to 21 in the Haftorah. Praise for God's deliverance. Then David spoke to the Lord the words of this song on the day when the Lord had delivered him from the hand of all his enemies and from the hand of Saul. And he said, the Lord is my rock and my fortress and my deliverer, the God of my strength in whom I will trust, my shield and the horn of my salvation, my stronghold and my refuge, my Savior. You save me from violence. I will call upon the Lord who is worthy to be praised. So shall I be saved from my enemies. When the waves of death surrounded me, the floods of ungodliness made me afraid. The sorrows of Sheol surrounded me. The snares of death confronted me. In my distress, I called upon the Lord and cried out to my God. He heard my voice from his temple, and my ears entered his ears, and my cry entered his ears. Then the earth shook and trembled, and the foundations of heaven quaked and were shaken, because he was angry. Smoke went up from his nostrils, and devouring fire from his mouth. Coals were kindled by it. He bowed the heavens also, and came down, with darkness under his feet. He rose upon the cherub, and flew, and he was seen upon the wings of the wind. He made darkness canopies around him, dark waters and thick clouds of the skies. From the brightness before him, coals of fire were kindled. The Lord thundered from heaven, and the Most High uttered his voice. He sent out arrows and scattered them, lightning bolts, and he vanquished them. Then the channels of the sea were seen. The foundations of the world were uncovered at the rebuke of the Lord, at the blast of the breath of his nostrils. He sent from above. He took me. He drew me out of many waters. He delivered me from my strong enemy, from those who hated me, for they were too strong for me. They confronted me in the day of my calamity. But the Lord was my support. He also brought me out into a broad place. He delivered me because he delighted in me. The Lord rewarded me according to my righteousness, according to the cleanness of my hands. He has recompensed me. I can attest to that. We'll go to the Brit Hadashah now. The New Covenant will be in Romans 11, 1 to 6. Israel's rejection not total. I say then, has God cast away his people? Certainly not. For I also am an Israelite, of the seed of Abraham, of the tribe of Benjamin. God has not cast away his people whom he foreknew. Or do you know what the scripture says of Elijah, how he pleads with God against Israel, saying, Lord, they have killed your prophets and torn down your altars, and I alone am left, and they seek my life. But what does the divine response say to him? I have reserved for myself 7,000 men who have not bowed the knee to Baal. Even so then, at this present time, there is a remnant according to the election of grace. And if by grace, then it is no longer of works. Otherwise, grace is no longer grace. But if it is by works, it is no longer grace. Otherwise, work is no longer work. Amen.
Baruch ata Adonai, Eloheinu melech haolam, Hashir b'cha banu mikol ha'amin, V'nata lano et torato, Baruch ata Adonai, Noten ha'Torah, Amen. Oh yes, English, yes, of course. Blessed are you, O Lord our God, King of the universe, who gave us the Torah of truth and has planted eternal life within us. Blessed are you, O Lord, giver of the Torah. Amen. Patrick.
Thanks, Johnny. Donnie? Thanks, Ronnie. Do we have any new visitors today? I see some of our snowbirds are coming back. Welcome back, Bob. And what's your name, young man?
James.
James, and where are you from, James? All right, well, welcome. So we have an Oneg Shabbat after the service, and you have a first pass to go to there. And I get to escort you to the front of the line. CDs and DVDs are available shortly after the service. The DVDs are from the previous week, but if you give us about 10 or 15 minutes, we'll have the CDs ready for you. And as like I said earlier, please join us for Oneg Shabbat back in Section Gimel, and we have lots of good eats back there for you. If you'd like to help for Oneg Shabbat, contact Gary. His phone number is up there, and he will tell you what you need to bring or what you need to do. Visit us at our website. We have ohavshalomministries.com. We're also available on live stream or any technical things that you need. You could ask our group back there, Robert, James, or myself, and we'll help you get to those websites and how to do that information. Live streaming, so those of you that can't make it, live stream is a new service that we offer. It's also archived, so you can go back. We have enough storage where we could almost store a whole year's worth of services up there. So if you want to look at that or have any challenges with that, you can do that. And we'll show you how to do that. Also on Roku, I don't know anything about Roku, but we're offering Roku as well. So it'll take you from your computer to your television set. Davidic dance practice in the foyer before this service. You can learn to do that. And Davidic dance practice is out in the foyer. Messianic calendars, we're marked down from the price of $12. We're down to $8. And we're down to one or two left. Going fast. Please pray for our homeless. I know Claudia and Russell are out there every weekend giving to them. So pray for their ministry. Pray for the homeless people that are in need of food, shelter, and just personal necessities. This is the group that they see every week. And some weeks we have people that actually come to the Lord. So thank you for your service and your ministry. If you'd like to donate to the ministry, there's a white box that is in the foyer, and some of the personal necessity things you can get with Claudia and Russell. They could tell you what they need, but there's a list up there on the screen as well. If you're interested in immersions or baptisms, you could see Donzel. He's the drum player up front, and he could talk to you about that. And then Ernesto's here as well. Thursday nights, we have the street fair, and Donzel and his team are out there evangelizing the gospel to the people at the street fair. Any comments, Donzel? All right. A lot of atheists. Five in a row. All right. And this is some of the contacts. We even had a Jewish atheist out there. So these are some of the people that they encountered at the street fair this week. Also similar to the homeless ministry, if you'd like to donate to the street fair ministry, just write on your check, please contribute to the street fair ministry. Tuesday night's Bible study. So our Bible studies are the first and third Tuesday of each month, and so the next one will be on October 18th, this coming Tuesday. And then we have a congregational prayer meeting that's held at Gary Solomon's and John Kaufman. It's at Gary Solomon's house. But they'll pray for you. So if you fill out these 3x5 cards, write your prayers on them. If you're watching us online, you can hit the prayer request, and then we'll make sure that those prayers get to Gary and Johnny, so we'll pray for you. You can just put it in the box back on the table. The next study will be October 25th. Women's Bible study is the second and fourth Thursday at Kirsten Jones' home. Kirsten and Carol are leading this, and it's a Hebrew word study. Sounds very interesting. And it begins in November. Continue praying for the members who are sick or need of our unsung loved ones. and the persecuted saints around the world, and definitely pray for our national leaders. Please remember to pray for our police departments, not only here in the Palm Springs area, but all around. They're really going through a big challenge this time, as well as our firefighters. And then pray for the peace of Jerusalem. May they prosper that love you. Johnny.
Thank you, Father, Lord of heaven and earth. Thank you for setting the kings in the nations. Thank you for setting the presidents in the earth. Thank you for managing the earth. Thank you for being the judge of the entire earth, and thank you for overruling the kings and the presidents of the earth. We pray for the street fair, the members who came to your servants this week. We pray that that they would all make it into your kingdom, that we would win many souls for you during the street fair. We pray for all those people that we touched, that heard the gospel, the good news, that Yeshua, your glorious high-throned Son who stands at your right hand, he's the only way to God the Father. There's no other way. Every other way, you're a thief and a robber. We also pray for Claudia and Russell's team and the people they encounter. We pray that you, since you love the stranger, the fatherless, and the widow, what this means is you raised my daughter who was taken away from me 18 months when she was 18 months old. So thank you for raising my daughter for me, Father. And we pray that you would bless the people that Claudia and Russell encounter every week, the homeless people. And we pray that you would improve their situations. We pray that you would get them jobs and move them off the streets and even get them cars and get them, bless them in any way you can, all their finances. We know that the two pillars that Solomon built in his temple, which were recently uncovered by archaeologists, they were named Jokin and Boaz, which means God is our strength. That's not a coincidence. It's not a coincidence that the tiles in the second temple where you threw the coins and where you healed the many people in the temple during Shabbat, they were recently unearthed in Jerusalem, proving that it's not Mecca, it's not Medina, it's Jerusalem. You chose Jerusalem. You're still choosing Jerusalem. It's still the glorious land. It's still where your Son walked the earth sinlessly in a holy fashion, reviled no one, spoke the truth to everyone, read their thoughts, knew their thoughts, knew their needs, and healed even on the Sabbath. And it was just 10 commandments that you gave the people, not 613 that were written in 1,000 years later after you walked the earth. It was just those 10. And we're those people that you created for your glory who are trying to keep those 10 and trying to win souls for your kingdom. Because if you had your way, every one of us who you created would enter your kingdom. But they say that even in the last days, man will still fight God. They'll hide themselves in the holes of the rocks. God will rain down 100-pound hailstones on them, and they're still going to fight God, and they're just like Nimrod did. They're not going to believe it. Even though it's a free gift. Yeshua means salvation. It's free for all mankind. But there's got to be a loophole. There's got to be something else in there. That what else do I have to do? No, it's not about our righteousness. We cover ourselves in the Lord's righteousness. The Lord Yeshua, he is our righteousness. We have no righteousness on our own. So thank you, God the Father. I pray that you would bless this message that the rabbi gives us, and thank you for placing us under the past president of the Messianic Jewish Alliance of America. I don't know, we don't deserve that, but that's what we got, and that's why we're here. I just pray that you would that you'd be glorified in every aspect in our lives as we walk out of here today. In the mighty name of Yeshua, amen. Now it's time to worship the Lord.
Shabbat Shalom. Let's see if I can remember the scripture. The Lord hears me when I call. Meditate in your heart upon your bed and be still. Offer the sacrifices of righteousness and trust in the Lord. Amen?
Amen.
Praise the Lord. Okay, Chuck. I mean, Terry. The mighty one of Israel.
Praise the Lord. Found a place to put my cane. It does double duty.
Hey.
It keeps the mic from dropping. Praise the Lord. One, two, three, four.
Watch your closet.
The mighty one of Israel.
Sorry about that, Ronnie.
How about the trees of the field? There's a picture of them right there. Huh? Hallelujah. Hine lo yanum. Sing along with us. You sound good. Better than you think.
English.
He that keepeth Israel neither slumbers nor sleeps.
Keepeth Israel, neither slumbers nor sleeps. Woo! Ooh, that's powerful. I guess that goes for us too.
This is gonna be Kodesh.
Yeah.
Praise the Lord.
And this song you got to wake up for, folks.
Praise the Lord.
Okay. In fact, it's called Awake.
One, two, three, four. Awake. 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 Put on your strength, oh Zion. Put on your beautiful garment, oh Jerusalem, the holy city. Shake off your dust and arise. Sing, oh heaven, be joyful, all the earth, and break out in singing, oh mountains. For the Lord has comforted his people Israel, and he will have mercy on Zion. Put on your strength, oh Zion. Put on your beautiful garment, oh Jerusalem, the holy city. Shake off your dust and arise. Sing, oh heaven, be joyful, all the earth, and break out in singing, oh mountains. For the Lord has comforted his people Israel, and he shall have mercy on Zion. Call on your God, he will answer you. If you call on your God, he will give an answer. Call on your God, call on your God, he will give an answer. Call on your God, he will answer you. If you call on your God, he will give an answer. Call on your God. In that day will he answer you. In that day, in that day, in that day when you call on your God.
Call on your God.
He will give an answer. Call on your God. He will answer you. If you call on your God, he will give an answer. Call on your God. Call on your God, he will give an answer. Call on your God, he will answer you. If you call on your God, he will give an answer. Call on your God.
In that day,
will he answer you. In that day, in that day, in that day when you call on your God. Awake, awake, put on your strength, oh Zion. Put on your beautiful garment, oh Jerusalem, the holy city. Shake off your dust and arise. Sing, oh heaven, be joyful, all the earth. Break out in singing, oh mountain. For the Lord has comforted his people Israel, and he shall be mercy on Zion.
Awake,
awake, put on your strength, oh Zion. Put on your beautiful garment, oh Jerusalem, the holy city. Take off your dust and arise. Sing, oh heaven, be joyful, all the earth. Break out in singing, oh mountain, for the Lord has comforted his people Israel, and he will have mercy on Zion. Awake, awake, call on your God, he will give an answer. Call on your God, he will answer you. You call on your God, he will give an answer.
Day.
In that day.
Patrick, come on up.
Well, I don't think we need to pay $1,000 to see a great worship service. We have it for free, and we get dividends in return.
Amen.
What a blessing with the worship team.
Thank you.
And I don't say this boastfully, but how about those dancers?
Amen.
I've been praying diligently for him because I think at a young age the Lord works in our lives.
Yes.
And I like seeing them demonstrating their ability to worship the Lord through their dance. And so it's very blessing to see that. I didn't really have this was kind of an impromptu request by Paul since Gary wasn't here. But I just wanted to, I was kind of reflecting on giving to the Lord and the seeds that we plant will yield a return. And so I remember an incident where we were very, very short on money, and I needed new tires on the car that would cost about $840. And so we didn't have the money, but we really needed the tires, and I had to get back and forth to work. I was working in San Bernardino at the time. And lo and behold, I used to work for a friend of the family when I was out of high school back in the 80s. And so I get this phone call, and he says, Pat, this is Bob Miller. And he says, when you worked for me back in the 80s, I put some money aside for you. And now my tax person says I need to give this money away. And so there was a check for me waiting. I went and picked it up. It was for $850. So it covered the cost of the tires. I went to Sam's Club, bought the tires for $840-something, and was able to get a hot dog and a soda on top of that. So the Lord gives abundantly, even though that was 20 years earlier. We just don't know how those seeds are going to manifest.
Amen.
Praise so let's pray for this offering. Thank you, Lord, for all you do for us. Thank you for, we know that you don't need the money, Lord. It's for us. It's for our lives that we can give to you and give the best that we have, Lord. And maybe it's not in money. Maybe it's in service, Lord. But we know that when we cast these seeds down upon you and not on rock, that it doesn't blow away, that it yields very good fruit. So we thank you for that, Lord. We thank you for all you do for us. Thank you for giving, Lord. In Yeshua's name, amen.
Amen.
Praise the Lord.
Thank you, Patrick.
The sacrifice lamb.
Have you ever?
Yeah.
Have you ever heard? Messiah has come.
salvation has come to the world. God's only Son to the world. Jesus, the one for the world. Yeshua is real. The prophets foretold.
Okay, Paul, come on up.
It's really so gratifying to see that, you know, we are a real congregation in the fullest sense. Especially gratifying are our dancers. Now, we have like three teachers, and none of them are here today, okay? But the dancing went on anyhow, and they did a really swell job. Thank you. And, you know, Gary's not here. He's here every week, but not this particular week. They're away for this during this week. But you know, life goes on as you know, for everything and so on and so forth. And we're beginning to see the first of our snowbirds, Bob Lalonde, is back. Welcome back, Bob. And so these things happen, and we fill in as necessary. And there are a lot of people taking an interest in what's going on here, and it's very gratifying. You know, I mean, we all go back there in that kitchen area, and we see everybody, you know, is working and so on and so forth. And, you know, these are acts of love, the bringing of the food and the preparing and the cleaning up and so on. People, this is their way of expressing their love for God and so on and so forth. You know, I get here at 8 o'clock, but I'm never the first one here, right? There are others who are here and which are recognized as shamashim in the congregation. We're going to install another one. Robert Navarro, I've asked if anybody has any reason why he shouldn't be, but we're going to wait until Gary is back before we do that. We want to have elders pray over him. So there's a lot of people working because we all feel like there's just something that needs to be expressed to the community, and it's a joint effort. So I want to call upon the children to come forward, and Carol also. Bruce and Bill, why don't you tall guys come on up forward. Bill, yeah, come on up. All right, we're going to pray over the children's class. Okay. All righty. And Bruce is going to lead in prayer. Did you know that Bruce is an Assembly of God pastor who has pastored seven congregations? Seven congregations. Finding out about people who have been pastors and who have gone to Bible college and seminary. There's Charlie Matheson over there. He's a seminary graduate and dentist. But to just modestly sit here in the congregation, you know, it's an amazing thing. Go, man, go.
Heavenly Father, we thank you for these precious children, for Carol, for teaching them. And Lord, we're reminded of your word that you said, open mine eyes that I might behold wondrous things out of your law. And I pray that this day that these children would discover precious truths out of your law and love you even more. And we ask this in Yeshua's name.
Amen. Hallelujah. Okay, children, go off and be blessed. Okay. Thank you. So, all right. Well, you know, we try to talk about the various aspects of life that we can take things from the scriptures and apply it to our everyday lives. We enjoy reading from both the Old Testament and the New Testament. You know, there are no new concepts in the new covenant. They are expansions, explanations, enlightenments about concepts that are all in the Old Testament. So in a way, to really understand the Old Testament, you need the New Testament. But in a way, to understand the New Testament, you really got to dive into the Old Testament. We try to do both. Okay. So today, we want to address the issue of friendship. So always nice to have friends. Okay. So please join me in a word of prayer. Holy Spirit, we pray to you because you are our pipeline. You are our holiness. We put you on like a cloak and like a garment. And behold, we are new creatures. For when we are in you, when we are submerged and hidden in you, we are our best selves. We thank you that you do gently whisper to us, never condemning, always encouraging. Encourage us now with the word that you inspired, you wrote down, you preserved, and you organized. pray that you would do this in Yeshua's name. Amen. Okay. Well, the first scripture we want to look at is in 2 Chronicles chapter 20 and verse 7. It says, Art not thou, O God, who didst drive out the inhabitants of this land before thy people Israel, and gave it to the seed of Abraham, thy friend, forever? So here it says that Abraham is a friend of God. Good to be friends with the creator of all that was created, a friend of the inventor of the universe, the one who's in charge of all the planets, the stars, and every atom and every molecule at the subatomic level. And it's good to have such a powerful and interesting friend. Let's turn to Isaiah 41, also speaking about being a friend of God. Chapter 41 of Isaiah and verse 8 says, Behold, thou Israel, art thou my servant Jacob, whom I have chosen, the seed of Abraham, my friend. So, good to be a descendant of Abraham, who was a friend of God. James also in chapter 2, okay, and verse 23, James 2:23 says, And the scripture was fulfilled, which saith, Abram believed God, and it was imputed to him for righteousness, and he was called the friend of God. So we're going to be talking today about four friends of God. Not just Abraham, he's one of four. So, but here we have in the New Covenant also, it says that Abraham was a friend of God. Why does it say that he was a friend of God? Okay. It says that it was that he had faith, okay, and that it was and there and that was imputed to him for righteousness. And it was based upon his faith. His faith cleansed him. He was an ordinary guy, a rancher. But, you know, he had a life. We don't know some of the more embarrassing aspects of Abraham's life. But what was preserved was a very substantial man. But all that messiness of his life, it all got cleaned up. By what? By virtue of the fact that he had faith in God, and that put him in right standing with God, and he was considered to be a friend of God, in right standing, righteous. If we asked Abraham, are you righteous? He probably would have said, oh no, I remember that disgusting thing that I did, and then there was that experience, and I just don't even want to tell you about it, and so on and so forth. But God cleaned it all up. God says, no, this guy is 100% righteous. You see, unless you're 100% righteous, you don't get into heaven. You got to be in right standing with God. There's no impurities being allowed in. And Abraham was being allowed in because he was, in God's sight, cleansed of all unrighteousness, and he was entirely righteous. Why? He did the faith thing. He had faith, and that's what it was. It can't be that simple. Oh, yes, it is that simple. It is just that simple. A lot of the world doesn't believe it because it's just too easy. It's just too simple. It can't just be that by doing some kind of mental trick that I can believe and that's going to take care of all that messy stuff in my life. Oh, my goodness, I'm not worthy of that. Well, of course you're not worthy of that. Who is? Who could be? Nobody. All right? We don't get in. Okay, because of anything other than our right standing with God, which is only produced by the cleansing of having faith in Him. We're taking His word for it, which is a reversal of the original crime in the Garden of Eden of not believing Him. That's it. We violated, we transgressed, we betrayed God, we chose not to believe Him. And all of the sins of the world came to our derivative from that first crime of not believing God. I can't correct all of the misdeeds of all of mankind over many centuries, okay, that came from that. But what we can do is reverse that initial crime by having faith, by believing God. If that's all he wants from us is to believe him. I mean, you'd think that, you know, it just doesn't take a mental giant to believe God. You don't even need a degree. Okay. Let's go on and let's find out some more about this. We're going to find out about somebody else who exhibited great friendship. Let's turn to 1 Samuel. Okay. 1 Samuel and chapter 18. 1 Samuel chapter 18. We're going to learn something about Jonathan. Okay. Jonathan was a friend of David. Let's look a little bit here at Jonathan. Chapter 18, verses 1 and 3. It says, "And it came to pass, when he had made an end to speaking unto Saul, that the soul of Jonathan was knit with the soul of David, and Jonathan loved him as his own soul." The soul is a central part of our being, and Jonathan felt so close to David and loved him as he loved himself. So, well, that says something. I mean, to love somebody that much, I mean, we all love ourselves, but it says that he loved him as if he were his own, it was as though he had loved himself. Then Jonathan and David made a covenant because he loved him as his own soul. So Jonathan is very much his, they're friends in the truest sense of the word, but Jonathan has a special regard for David, holds him in high esteem. And it's he isn't just kind of a peer. He really kind of, I think, looks up to David. And he's always looking out for David's welfare. He wants to be his friend. What can I do to show my friendship with you all the more? Okay. So this is Jonathan. We're learning about Jonathan's commitment to David. And in the next chapter, chapter 19 and verse 2, it says, "But Jonathan, Saul's son, delighted much in David. And Jonathan told David, saying, Saul, my father seeks to kill you. Now, therefore, I pray, take heed to thyself until the morning and abide in the secret place and hide yourself." So now here's Jonathan. He has a loyalty bind. And his loyalty bind is that he recognizes that his father is having unwholesome thoughts. His father's getting sucked into negativity. The people are saying that David, that Saul has killed his thousands, but David has killed his tens of thousands. And this bothers Saul. And he resents David. And the more he thinks about it, the more galling it is, and the more negative it is, and setting him that negativity of really hating David and so on and so forth, and he indulges in it and sinks deeper into it, and Jonathan hates to see it, hates to see his father going downhill spiritually in a sense, but what's he to do? And now he recognizes that there is murder in the heart of his father against his friend. Boy, what a bind. What a bind. Let's turn the page again to chapter 20 and verse 4. It says, "Then said Jonathan unto David, whatsoever thy soul desireth, I will even do it unto you." In verse 9. "And Jonathan said, far be it from you, for if I certainly that evil were determined by my father to come against you, I would tell you." So here Jonathan is taking a side, and it's a courageous thing to do, because Jonathan he's in line to become the king. I mean, he's a prince of Israel, and he is in line to have the crown and be a really big man. His father's going to pass away at some time. He'll be the inheritor of the crown, okay? Whereas David is his friend. Now, it would have been oh so easy, if they had buses, to throw David under the bus. okay, and say, well, you know, you mess with the king, you know, what are you going to do, David? You know, I mean, I'm your friend, but, you know, reasonable is reasonable. And he is my father. Huh? And so, you know, I have the crown to protect and so on and so forth. But, you know, you've got to cure this thing with my father. See, he really was in a very bad bind, but he chose his friendship with David over that of his earthly father. What a decision. What was he prepared for his friendship to cost him? Still in chapter 20, we're at verse 13 through 17. The Lord do so much to Jonathan, but if it please my father to do you evil, then I will show it to thee and send you away, that thou may go in peace, and the Lord be with you, and as had been with my father. And thou shalt only, while yet I live, show me the kindness of the Lord, that I die not. So basically, Saul is really after David, and it's becoming more and more clear to Jonathan that his father means to kill David. Now that's an unwarranted crime. His father's going to be a murderer, and he says, "Look, I can't tell you at the moment whether he's going to actually carry this through or not, but if he is going to, I'm going to let you know so that you can flee." But here's the deal. Remember me. Remember me later, that I'm showing you this loyalty, but I don't want anything. But you know. But if you would not cut off your kindness to my house forever, my future generations, you know, not when the Lord cuts off enemies of David, every one from the face of the earth. So Jonathan made a covenant with the house of David, saying, let the Lord even require it at the hand of David's enemies. And Jonathan caused David to swear again because he loved him, and for he loved him as he loved his own soul. So Jonathan is prepared to show his loyalty to David, to save David's life, putting him first before his father. His father's going to be very angry about this. Son, don't you realize I'm protecting his crown for you? Well, but Dad, that's murder. But Jonathan says, look, I want to do this. You're my friend. And I'm just asking one thing, that you'll remember my descendants, that you'll be kind to them. I ask for nothing for myself. But you've got a great future, David. I can see it. I can see that you have a great future, and that you are heading, you have a quality. It's gonna, your future is bright. You're going to rise. And when you do, remember that I showed you loyalty and reward my descendants. Not much to ask, only for his descendants, asking nothing for himself. But this is what you would call a selfless friend, and it's really costing Jonathan to show favor to his friend rather than his father. And in a way, he's putting David, the rising of David, before the rising of his own future, which was to be king. He put all that in jeopardy for his friend. That the natural, he's setting aside the natural way and going with the goodness, the essential goodness and godliness of David. Let's go to the third friend. The third friend, which would be in the book of John, all right, in the New Covenant, all right. And that's chapter 13 and verse 23. So it says, now there was leaning on Yeshua's bosom one of his disciples whom Yeshua loved. Okay. And of course, this is John. Okay. And John is described as the one of the disciples whom Yeshua loved. This also comes up again in chapter 19. And verse 26, all right, about John, also describing him this way, okay, that in chapter 26. I think I have that right. Yeah. When Yeshua therefore saw his mother and the disciple standing by, whom he loved. So I thought Yeshua loved all of the disciples. Why is this one singled out yet again in the scriptures as the disciple that he loved? Okay. Well, that's not the only time that happened. Here, John is being distinguished in this way. Chapter 20 of the book of John speaks, I guess John's the writer of, about this himself, and so there's a modesty. He's not exactly naming himself, but in chapter 20 and verse 2, it says, "Then she runneth and cometh to Simon Peter and to the other disciple whom Yeshua loved and said unto them," and so on. So again, there's this description of the one that Yeshua loved. Last one. Chapter 21, verse 7, says, "Therefore that disciple which Yeshua loved said unto Peter, It is the Lord. Now when Simon Peter heard that it was the Lord, he girded his fisherman's coat," and so on and so forth, and so on. So again and again and again, John is being described as a disciple that was seemed to be distinguished in this unusual way, that he's the one known as the one who was beloved of the Messiah. Wow, what a distinction. So I mentioned that there was that there were four individuals that were friends of God. All right, so here John seems to be, what does that mean? Yeshua loves all the disciples, us included. What does this have to do with John? Why is he so distinguished as being the beloved disciple? Well, I don't know, I'm guessing. You know, you can have a lot of friends, but who do you want to hang out with? You know, who do you want to hang out with? And it would seem as though maybe he just, There was a connection between John and Yeshua, like there was a connection between Jonathan and David. Special, you know, sometimes there's a chemistry that happens between people. It's hard to explain, but you just like spending time with this other person, hanging out, and so on and so forth. And you're just completely unguarded with them, and so on and so forth. So here we. Here we have these three friendships as an example of, now, what about the fourth one? Who's the fourth one? Well, let me see. Ethel's the fourth one. And Loretta's the fourth one. Okay. Linda's the fourth one. Each of us is also a friend of God. Okay. Why are we considered to be friends of God? Because we have faith. It was the only thing that cured Abraham's problems and cleansed Abraham was his faith. Now we have Jonathan who puts David, he renounces his claim on earthly crown and says, "No, I put you before me." Well, in a way, when we are deferring to the Messiah, when we're putting the expansion of the Messiah's program first, aren't we doing what Jonathan did? Huh? Not me. It's more important that you be glorified. You're the one whose program is best for the kingdom, King David. All right, you know best. You deserve this elevation more than me, and so I'm going to put me second, and I'm going to put you first. When we're believers, aren't we doing that? Aren't we taking and saying, all right, what I want to achieve in life is important, okay, but I'm going to put it second to the glorification and expansion of Messiah's program. You see, so like Abraham, we get cleansed by having faith, and we are in the pattern of being a friend of God in the way that Jonathan preferred David. Now we have John, and what is he? He's a regular old believer. He did not know that he was Revelation. He was a young man in his 20s, okay? And he didn't realize that he was going to have such a prominent role. He was just a regular old believer, okay? But he had a special intimacy with the Messiah. Isn't that true of us also? Don't we have an intimacy with the Messiah? And don't we like hanging out with him? Well, you know what? He likes hanging out with us too. So we are very much like John as well. So now let's see. I'm a friend of God. I qualify the way on the same basis that Abraham qualified. Okay. While I am like Jonathan, I do want to put the Messiah's program first because that's the best thing for the kingdom. I have a certain amount of earthly inheritance. I have, but really, I know that David, or in this case, the model for Messiah, that his program is best for the kingdom. And so I'm deferring to the Messiah. All right, I'm a friend of God, okay? Not only like Abraham, but also like Jonathan. And then there's John. Well, we're intimate with God. We're intimate with the Messiah the same way that John was. Well, how do I show friendship to some other? You know, it's really, you could say, well, that's good. I want to be a friend of God. I am a friend of God, and so on and so forth. I can't be bothered with these other people. You know, they hurt me, and I can't count on them, and they're weak, feet of clay, and they disappoint me, and so on and so forth. I'm okay with being a friend of God, but these other people, that's hard to be a friend of some other demented, soiled, defective human being. They will fail me. Why do I want to invest my friendship in them? Yeah. So, well, you know, we have to kind of cure ourselves of the notion, okay, that God is a person, but this, and they're persons too. It's all the same thing, okay? God is a person. He's the most important person, but he is a person. Every other believer is also a person. Every other one is a person. And every other believer is a friend of God, okay? So therefore, when I am being a friend of somebody who has put on Messiah, all right, they're in the Messiah. They're in the Spirit. They are soaring spiritually. They just look at Messiah and so forth. And it's real easy to be friends with them because they put on Messiah. They are in the groove. They're in the Holy Spirit and so on and so forth. And I love them. They're so good and they're so unselfish and they only say kind things and so on and so forth. And if they would just remain in the Spirit, I could be their friend. Problem is, they don't. Well, you know, I was thinking about Gary's not here today. I'll talk behind his back. I'm going to make an example of Gary since he's not here. Gary, he doesn't drink any alcohol. Okay. He's not a repentant alcoholic. He just doesn't drink alcohol. So that's why I'm picking on him, because he's a non-alcoholic. He doesn't drink alcohol. But suppose he did, okay? And Gary's a spiritual guy, but suppose, I mean, and I'm his friend and so on, but suppose he got stinking drunk. I mean, throwing up drunk. I'm talking about staggering drunk, huh? I'm talking about delusional drunk. I'm talking about it's so bad the guy can't stand up, all right? Now, I'm his friend. Am I going to go over and say, Simon, do you see what the slob did? And not if I'm his friend. If I'm his friend, right, I'm not going to say anything about it. I'm going to cover it over. I'm going to try to preserve his reputation, huh? If I'm his friend. If I'm not his friend, well, now I'm going to tell people. That makes me feel superior. I am not falling down drunk, and I don't allow that to happen to myself, but look at this poor slob. He can't help himself at all. And so on. So, but if I'm his friend, I'm going to cover over for him. Right? Because I saw something. I saw something. And it put an intimacy between us. Okay? An intimacy. An intimacy of humanity. And I have a choice of either covering it over or allowing the world to see his embarrassment. Can we see that if I'm really his friend, I won't embarrass him? I'll kind of cover it over. I'll put the best face on Gary that I can. Okay? And hopefully, since I'm not telling anybody, and I'm the only one who saw it, that all memory of it will be erased. Good chance it'll be erased. And I will have proven my friendship to Gary. And you know what? He would appreciate it. And we will have shared an intimacy, a human intimacy. Almost a holy thing to have to share kind of an intimacy, a friendship like that. Well, I say that each of us is the fourth friend of God because each of us is in that situation. You see, when we depart from this earth, all right, there were many experiences that we had that did not show off our best self. I mean, there were many times, many, 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 many times that we disappointed ourselves, that we disappointed relatives, and we disappointed associates, and there were many times that our lower nature came out and we betrayed each other and so on and so forth. And you know what, when this life is over, huh, and we go to heavenly places, God is covering it over, huh, and none of that will be known in heavenly places. Hallelujah. Now, how do I know that? Well, because God said, because the scriptures say that it will be, that we will be separated from our sins as far as the east is from the west. Infinitely so, okay, that there will be no trace of it, no memory of it. God edits it out, just like I, as Gary's friend, I edited out his falling down drunk, and there was an intimacy between us. So it is in heaven. That my friendship with God and yours also as the fourth friend of God, that our transgressions, our embarrassments, all of our failures no longer exist. They're not permitted into heaven. They would be soiling the fabric of heaven, and God will not permit them in. Those memories are, they are erased. They are edited out. We don't know what Abraham did, but in the writing of the Lamb's Book of And in Genesis and elsewhere, okay, that the foibles of Abraham have been written out. Okay, now he may have done some things that were not first class, but God had purpose for those things and turned out to glorify God. Okay, but in general, that's what happened. Was Abraham, all of his foibles got edited out in the writing of the scriptures, huh? Same thing with Jonathan. Hey, he was not a perfect man, huh? But it got edited out. So it is our future that our failings are being edited out, not permitted in heaven at all. And so, I don't know, I mean, just project ourselves forward. We're all enjoying ourselves, and we're all, but I don't have any recollection of your sins. I don't have any recollection of my sins. All that's gone. All that's gone. And all we can focus on is to accentuate the positive because the negative has been eliminated. Sounds like a song. Okay. Why? Why? Well, because we're in right standing with the Lord. How do we get to be in right standing with the Lord? Well, we did the magic trick. We said, I believe, God. I believe that what you're telling me is the truth. I believe you've been maligned. I believe you've been lied about. I believe your scriptures. I believe that it's no supernatural thing, that the Bible has been preserved and that it has this quality that although there were many authors, they all seem to be in agreement. It's a supernatural book, and I believe it. I choose to believe it, even when it looks bad, and it looks like it can't be true. It's not happening. I still believe it. I still choose to believe that you are a truth teller, O God, and that everything bad said about you, I am going to discard from my thinking. You do have my good intent, even though I can't see it right now. I choose to believe you. And that's what cleansed me of all unrighteousness, was the fact that I chose to have faith when it didn't seem like that was the cool thing to do. Okay? And that washed me out really clean. I'm cleansed in the blood of atonement. I'm cleansed of it. It no longer is there. God does not recognize it. It's as though it didn't happen. None of that in my life happened. Oh, I have to live with maybe the consequences in this life, but I'm fading soon. Not too soon, honey. But it's all gone. So I have to live with the consequences in this life only. It's only in this life that I have to pay a consequence for what I do. The law, the comprehensive law of sowing and reaping. So whatever bad behavior I do, there is a consequence in the area of misbehavior. Okay? But that's only in this life. In the next life, all gone. I exhibited faith. That did it for you. And now only the good things that we did to honor Messiah, only the things to expand his kingdom, preserved. Those are all medals. Those are all medals on our chest. Those are stripes on our sleeve. Huh? Those are commemorations of the righteous things that we did to show our friendship with God. Huh? And we're walking around in heaven for all eternity wearing those medals and wearing those awards. Look at what they did here. And look at that. When nobody was looking, look at how they honored me. You know? Those are all preserved. Every single one of them. Every single one of them is preserved. And that becomes our permanent inheritance. Our permanent inheritance. The thing that lasts as the thing that we did for God when it wasn't so clear. When we decided to venture out, take a chance, show our love for God, and so on and so forth. When it wasn't so clear that there would ever be any reward. But it's the fact we took a chance and we believed God and in his justice. That memory of that which we did for God is preserved forever. Now, forever is a very, very long time. But it's preserved forever. And those rewards go with us. And they say, Steve and Monty, they were my friends. They were my friends when the chips were down, when the world was not believing me. Okay? They stood up for me. That's why they got the gold medal and the green medal, the two of them. Huh? Because that's what they did. They demonstrated their friendship with me. And that's why they were beloved of mine, even in their... I liked hanging out with them, and they liked hanging out with me. Huh? And that was it. Now, that's a great thing. That's a great thing, but we forget that. All we can think about is lunch today, you know, and dinner tomorrow, and can I get my paycheck, and so on, and will I get my bonus? And we're so consumed with the day-to-day, hour-to-hour, week-to-week stuff that we forget about what's really going on. Huh? We need to put on our long-range thinking cap. In the long range, that's what counts. What counts is our friendship with God, okay, and the things we do to act on that friendship, not a theoretical thing, but the things we actually do to demonstrate and prove our friendship, okay, when it doesn't look like that's such a good idea, but we do it anyhow, just for the love of it and the investment in the future, like Jonathan did, oh, David, got a great future. I know you got a great plan for the kingdom and so on and so forth. And it's you first. And I'm going to sacrifice my own welfare on your behalf. That's what's going on. That's what we got to keep in mind, is what is our permanent future. Now, you know, you say, how did this come about so easily? I just kind of, I'm a beneficiary of all of that. Yeah. What happens to the poor soul, the poor person who is so small-minded that they listen to what everybody else has to say, that there's no God, that the scriptures don't count, that the Messiah is a myth? They're just continuing on because they're listening. Oh, serpent, can you tell me some more? Oh, snake in the grass, inform me some more. And they just keep believing it and believing it and believing it. And so they continue to believe it in this life, huh? And they're celebrated in this life. And maybe they become famous in this life, or make a lot of money in this life, or become powerful in this life, and they have their reward. A big deal. Big deal. Because this life is over. And when this life is over, what do they have? What do they have? You know what? They're not cleansed. All they got is, their sins are not separated as far as the east is from the west. They're ever present with them forevermore. So they got all these lousy, tainted, dirty pictures in their minds. And all they have is regrets. They don't got good medals in heaven for what they did on God's behalf. They don't have the good medal, the faith. They didn't have the faith medal. They never exhibited the faith. So they don't get this cleansing. Okay? They're not separated as far as east is from the west. All they got is all the bad memories. Oh, yeah, it felt so good because I had so much fame. I had so much power. Do you realize what an important person I am? Do you know who you're speaking to? I mean, I'm a really important person. And you know what? All of that, whatever they had to do to get there, whoever they had to climb over, whatever it was, however they got there, okay, they're just left with the lousy memories forevermore. Talk about living, and you're in heaven, where everybody holds contempt for you. Some to everlasting life, some to everlasting contempt. The poor slobs that can't catch on, that's what they're stuck with. They're stuck with this future of only regrets are preserved, and they don't got no medals to take with them. Yeah, that's a really lousy future. I can't think of a more lousy future than that. So when we're out there and we're trying to convince people, yes, there is a reproach for standing up for Messiah. There's a reproach. But we have committed ourselves to clearing his name. He's been lied about. He's been maltreated. There's been misinformation and so on and so forth. And his reputation has been soiled and so on and so forth. And we have committed ourselves. We are going to do what we can to clean up his name, the name that's above all names. And we're going to stand up for him. And we are standing up for him. And in the standing up for him, we're standing up for our friend. Our friend who does everything for us. And so don't we think that he appreciates that when we stand up for his name? When we stand up for his reputation, of course he appreciates it. And as a friend, you think he just sloughs that off like with no reward? Hebrews 10:6 says, "For is God so unfaithful as to forget every one of our good deeds, any of our good deeds?" No, he's not so unfaithful. He is faithful to remember every single one of them. And there is a reward in this life as well as the next. Oh, that's a good one. In this life as well as the next. Okay. I'm telling you, when we became believers, we didn't fully understand what the heck we were doing. We walked into something that was way beyond our understanding of what was in it for us and how good, what a good thing we signed up with. We just kind of inched our way over the line. We became believers. We got a little more invested in it. We took it a little more seriously, and gradually we grew in it and more committed to it and so on and so forth. We didn't realize what we were doing. We don't know the beginnings of all of the benefits that we walked into by doing this simple thing of saying, "Okay, God, I believe you." You say, "Well, what is that? That's nothing." It's not nothing to God. It's a really big deal. really big deal. And he is a rewarder of us who diligently seek him. Let's close in a word of prayer. Oh, Father, thank you for rewarding this seemingly small thing that we did by believing you. And we thank you, Messiah Yeshua, that you went and paid the price that there would be blood of atonement, of atonement, and that that was a perfect sacrifice made by you who had no sin. And we thank you that because of that, we have the Holy Spirit that walks with us and talks with us and is our intimate friend. We do thank you, Lord, that you're gonna clean us up, that in the next life, forevermore, we're gonna have your reward. And all the things that we do in this life, that you are our friend. You're watching out for us. You're protecting us. Sometimes we don't thank you much for it, but we know that you are always protecting us and watching for us. Well, thank you for this time together in Yeshua's name. Amen. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Okay. Now, it's time to call on Jerry Cohen. And he tells me that this week we're going to be singing Ain't Kelohenu, a traditional closing prayer for a Shabbat service. Why don't we all stand?
I got sound. Good. All right, everybody join me in singing. Ain't Kelohenu, ain't Kadonenu, ain't Kimokenu, ain't Kamoshienu, me Kelohenu. Mi kadonenu, mi kimalkenu, mi kamoshienu. No del Eloheinu, no del Adonenu, no del Malkenu, no del Moshienu. Baruch Eloheinu, baruch Adonenu, baruch Malkenu, baruch Moshienu. Atohu Eloheinu, Atahu Adonenu, Atahu Malkenu, Atahu Moshienu. There is none like our God, there is none like our Lord. There is none like our King, there is none like our Savior. Who is like our God? Who is like our Lord? Who is like our King? Who is like our Savior? Let us thank our God, let us thank our Lord, let us thank our King. Let us thank our Savior. Blessed is our God, blessed is our Lord, blessed is our King, blessed is our Savior. It is you who is our God, it is you who is our Lord, it is you who is our King, it is you who is our Savior. Shabbat shalom, everyone.